Thank you for the kind introduction, Michiel. Good morning. My name is John, and 10 years ago, I founded 365, an influencer marketing agency. And for those of you who might not know what influencers are, those are people with a passion or an expertise, with a large following on social media. And those could be on Instagram, YouTube, TikTok, or even be e-sporters. And I'm going to tell you about why they are inevitable, especially if you want to reach the synthetic generation. Okay, let's see. We started in 2010, so we've been around for quite some time now. And what we do is like social media campaigns, but where we really move the needle is creating creative campaigns, strategic ambassador programs with influencers, and of course, creating YouTube formats. And what do we do on a daily basis? Let me explain real short. It's like three things, actually. We make perfect match, because it's very important to find the right person that really fits with the brand personality of your company. Then we develop a concept for the campaign or the strategy to create a real powerful ambassador program. And of course, we have to run it as well. And I'm going to tell about the inevitability of influencer marketing based on three things. First, the market, then some important and major trends, and of course, also what's next for your company. And that really depends on the phase you're in right now. The market's growing fast. As you might have heard, influencers are everywhere. If you have small children, you probably heard some names from YouTubers. And it's in the early days, it were specifically the fashion and the beauty industry that were the game changers, but right now, influencer marketing is popping up in basically every industry. So, is it new? No, it's not a new thing. It's basically word of mouth, only now in the digital era. People with expertise or passion just gained a lot of followers, a big audience, because of internet and social media and ability to follow those people. But if we look back, there are three changes in human behavior that lie beneath that. And the first one is that we're not going online, we're living online. We're spending more time on social media than we spend eating, actually. The second one is that 74% of people is actively avoiding, ignoring, deleting, unsubscribing brand messages. And the third one is we lost trust in brands. That started in the financial crisis, but even nowadays, even Facebook has problems with trust. So, influencers are the natural bridge, the natural conduits to reach your audience, because your audience is following them. And it's very important as well, because 96% of people talking about brands do not follow these on social media, so they are literally some kind of bridge. So, the question that was asked a few times this conference was, okay, but how much does an influencer cost? Well, that depends on a few factors, to be honest. But here on the left, you have smaller influencers to bigger influencers, and you know the prices for one Instagram post vary from a few hundred dollars to actually a few thousand dollars. So it's pretty interesting. But if you look to the right, this lady with the lipstick, who knows her name? Kylie Jenner, that's right. And she has one of the biggest followings on YouTube. Actually, she has 141 million followers on Instagram. And any idea what a brand should pay for a post? One single photo. That's not in this league at all. It's like $1.2 million for one post, so that's really big. So no wonder the new generation, the synthetic generation, wants to be an influencer, and they see it as the new summer job. So where are we now? Is this a hype? Well, actually, we've passed the hype. This is the Gartner hype cycle for digital marketing and advertising. And if you look closely, we're not here in front of the peak of inflated expectations. We actually just left the valley of disillusionment after Fyre Festival, getting ready for explosive growth. And that's what we're seeing in research as well. 63% of all marketeers plans to increase the share of influencer marketing in their marketing budget. So that's pretty pretty big. But if you look at the market, it's really exploding. It's like 1.7 billion in 2016 to almost 10 billion in 2020. So it's almost double from 2018. So if you're not doing anything with influencers right now, I would suggest stop talking about it and take action and really start, because it works. It works for branding. This is a neuro research that had been done with measured how your brain responded to influencer content. And influencer content is 277% stronger as it goes for emotional intensity than TV. And it also has an 87% higher memory encoding. That means branding, that means priming, remembering a brand. But this is branding, it also works for sales. just look at the first stat over here. It's like 58 of consumers bought something which they saw in an influencer piece of content in the last 6 months only. So no wonder marketeers are increasing their market share. And how much do they increase their market share? Well, so I have to get used to the stage. Almost half of the brands want to spend at least 20% of their marketing budget, and there's even 11% of them that wants to allocate even more, like 40% or more of their marketing budget. So what does that look like? Well, let me introduce you to the classic influencer marketing example of Revolve. Revolve is a clothing brand in the United States that started out with influencer marketing in about, I think it was around 2010, started sending free clothes to bloggers. And right now, they have like a community of 3,500 influencers around the world, constantly promoting their stuff. And you know, they've really cracked the case how to make money from influencer marketing, because they get 70% of their business through influencers. That's around $700 to $800 million a year. And as their brand marketing or their chief brand officer says, we saw influencers as a direct pipeline to our customers because their target audience doesn't watch TV, read magazines anymore. So once again, bridges to your target audience, natural conduits. And what's even more spectacular, they just went public, and snatched a market cap from $1.5 billion. And what was pretty, interesting is that almost 80 times in their IPO filing, the word influencer was mentioned. So you might think, wow, that's a dot-com, you know. But also traditional companies like Estee Lauder are moving into this space. Like 75% of their marketing budget will go to digital, and most of it will go to influencer marketing. So if you look at the budgets involved, it's really astounding. It was only $900 million in 2017. So that's pretty big. So you might say, it's getting real. You better think strategically how to work with influencers to reach your audience. So a few of the trends. There are a lot of trends. A lot of trends happen every day in this industry. So every time I wake up, something has happened. And one of the biggest trends, it might be interesting for you as well, is the B2B market. In the US, already 31% of influencer marketing campaigns is targeted at a B2B audience. So that's pretty amazing, and we're seeing that here in Europe as well. So why is it important? Well, first of all, the word influencer doesn't really apply in a business-to-business scene, so we call them thought leaders. And that's very important, because 55 of the decision makers, B2B decision makers, looks if the selling party has thought leadership skills and wants to that's one of the criteria in which they decide if they want to work with them. It's but there's still a gap, because the other side of the table, And thinks it's not so important after all. It's only 40%, almost 40% of the sellers that believe thought leadership really helps them in the sales process. So there's much work to be done. So once again, back to to Kylie Jenner, with her 140 million following. She has managed to leverage this audience into some real capital. She became the youngest billionaire ever by sending lipstick to her Instagram audience. So that woke a few brands up. It's like, okay, those big influencers, we can do something with that. And this is Nikki Tutorials. Oh, sorry. This is Nikki de Jager from Nikki Tutorials. She's a big YouTuber, and she has become the special beauty advisor from Marc Jacobs. And these collaborations open up real and new possibilities. For example, original products, because of their expertise, their passion, they know what the market demands in terms of products. But also, you're not going to make a boring ad. You let her make the ad if you're a really smart brand. So this is what they did, and they also made a very original ad, so to say, together with Snoop Dogg.
A certain flavor she looking for. That's why she tapping it in. Lightly up under the eyes. Lightly, Nikki, lightly. Look at it. Oh, wow, lip gloss.
This is actually, I have to admit, the first makeup tutorial that I watched, because Snoop Dogg was in it and he was narrating her her makeup routine. So another example is is Douchebags and the cooperation with Jay Alvarez. Douchebags is a bag brand. And they've cooperated with Jay, and Jay's extreme sports / adrenaline junkie. And they created a whole new set of bags together, a whole new collection based on his personality, his tattoos, life motto. And once again, you don't make a boring ad, you let Jay Alvarez do the ad. And in his way, he's not going to promote it in a boring way. No, he's going to jump out of a helicopter in one of his own bags. This is a commercial that everyone saw from beginning to end, without blinking. These kind of social media stars, they have a pretty big budget as well, so you gotta have deep pockets as a brand. So there's a counter movement going on, and we call those types of influencers that are real small but really effective, micro and nano influencers. A micro influencer is an influencer with about 50K fan base, and nano influencers could be people like you and me with 1,000 fans. But they're really effective because most of the time they operate in special niches and have a high engagement, higher than the bigger influencers. So they're perfect for a program. So you can pick 10, 20, 50 of those guys and girls and just figure out a program and continue to make content on a 365-day basis a year. Another trend is homegrown influencers. If you are a large retailer like Macy's, why not create influencers or creators from your own employees? So that's what they did. They started out with about 20 creators, stylists, fashionists that work at Macy's, and started talking about their passion, sometimes even about Macy's, not all the time. And that program has exploded from 20 to 400 employees in about 8 months. And they're seriously considering not working with bigger influencers anymore. And there's also another option you can do. And this is really the type of influencer that really fits the synthetic generation. It's a virtual influencer. This is little Michaela. She has 1.7 million followers on Instagram. And, well, she's real, but she's fake. She's real. You don't really know. Well, you know, but for the audience, she's real. She has a storyline. She tells about her adventures, has emotions, even has a virtual boyfriend. And, as you might have noticed, she even has sponsorships. She works with the biggest brands alive. I'll come back to that. But also, the success and popularity of little Michaela has woken up some brands that thought, hey, wow, can we do something with the virtual influencers? So here's the example of this guy. You might recognize him a bit, but it's a mix between Chris Hemsworth, the Thor actor, and the Kentucky Fried Chicken founder, Colonel Sanders. Basically the hipster version of Colonel Sanders, that's making content and talking to his audience, and also does collaborations with brands like Pepsi. And they become more and more interactive. So they leave the virtual realms to interact with real influencers like Bella Hadid. So this is a kiss between little Michaela and Bella Hadid for the Calvin Klein campaign. And over here, you see one of the biggest campaigns from Samsung. This is Team Galaxy. And what you're seeing over here is world famous DJ Steve Aoki. And on the right, eSporter Ninja. And in the middle, there she is, little Michaela, creating content all year long for Samsung. But when it gets really interesting, if those CGI/virtual influencers become smart, through artificial intelligence, then a whole new range of possibilities opens up again. For example, this is Salvador Dali. Some of you might know that he's not amongst us anymore, but he has about 150 ways to welcome you in his museum.
Greetings. I am Salvador Felipe Jacinto Dali y Domenech, and I am back.
So, actually, virtual influencers can do something that their flesh and blood counterparts can't, like interact with everyone on a personal basis, or even make a selfie.
Before you leave, you will take a picture with me?
Sure. Yeah.
Alors. Uno. Dos. Tres.
Yeah, so that has certainly potential. So, the last trend, advertisers will become publishers. Not all advertisers, but like I mentioned before, people don't like to watch advertising anymore. So, stop with irritating people with advertising, start publishing content that people really want to see with influencers. So, one of the most famous examples is Red Bull. Maybe if you paid attention to the J. Alvarez video, you saw Red Bull already in there. Red Bull spends about 1/5 of their budget, marketing budget, on stuff, on advertising that says Red Bull give you wings, and the rest all goes to extreme sports, helping extreme sporters, influencers over there, to achieve their dreams. And like the Red Bull marketing director said, nobody's going to a website and spend 45 minutes looking at a video about a drink. So this is the future. And if you're going to publish, then you should consider YouTube, because YouTube is the number one video site, becoming more popular than even TV, right besides Netflix. But YouTube knows a business model, so you can earn money from your videos on YouTube. And it's the second largest search engine in the world. So if you look for information, you can bet that YouTube is among there. And let's not forget that 1 in 5 shoppers consult an unboxing video before they buy something. So, wrapping up the trends, we see a transition from advertising to content, from traditional to more YouTube, from celebs to influencers, from annoying ads to inspiring with content, and spending money on advertising, earning money on your content. Then, What's next? Well, what's next in store in influencer marketing for your company really depends in what phase you're in. So we've developed a roadmap, and that roadmap has a few phases. So first, of course, is experimentation in your advertising. So it's like more like flat influencer marketing in a commercial, a campaign, start and stop, and a continuous program. And the holy grail for some is publishing. And obviously, if you do it right, you start there and you go up. And each phase has its own objectives, KPIs, type of influencers that you can work with. And to put it in perspective, I'll show you a few examples. Experimentation, okay, that's obvious. You just do something. You have an influencer that you know probably won't pay him or her. The results won't be that big. And the basic objective of this is learning. Then you have influencer advertising. That's basically make a commercial, or only instead of actors, use influencers. Can be very effective, but still like an ad. And it's isolated. What you really should do better is like create a campaign that's not standalone, that's integrated with the rest of your marketing mix. And the objectives here would be to work with some bigger influencers to really create engagement, branding, and sales. Well, that would be a bonus. Then the program. This is when you run a program with bigger and smaller influencers, maybe homegrown influencers, all types of influencers to each other, and all year long. So you have visibility all year long, and the benefits of this is very cost effective because you can make a price for multiple videos, and you can demand exclusivity, which is beneficial to the authenticity. And the main objectives here are branding and reputation. And finally, publishing. This is an example of a Dutch YouTube channel we did about horses and girls who love horses. So it really feels like a niche, but like almost 600,000 girls in this YouTube network. And it's really, really interesting for a lot of brands to partake in sponsorships over there. So the objective here is, once again, is branding reputation, but also using the business model to earn money from all this content that's being created on a day-to-day basis. Looking back to the influencer marketing roadmap, I've split it into two parts, actually. And if you look below the fold, so to say, you're basically doing sales activation. People are seeing your content, and that will have an effect on sales, but will be short term. But if you work continuously, for example, in a program, it will be long term. And that's proven, that's researched by several ROI gurus like Les Binet and Peter Field. So that's not my idea, but it really fits this model as well. And they say if you do sales activations, well, the effect will last a maximum of 6 months. If you do a long term, you'll see that the effect of the sales will accumulate and become bigger and bigger. So you do more sales if you have a long term program. And also build your brand in the meanwhile. And that's very interesting, because if you build a brand, people will buy, will be happy to pay more for the brand and get brand preferences, and will be very important in the future when your brand's on Amazon, for example, and you want really that people want to know the name of your brand and really look up your brand. So when you're back tonight, tomorrow, I hope you will remember a few things. The first one is that you should think in programs. It's right now the most cost-effective and also the most best thing to work with influencers. The second one is that you do not rely solely on external influencers. So create your own from your own organization, or even your own virtual influencer. And the last one, well, it just stay ahead. Think about what Darwin said about species. That surely holds up for companies as well. And maybe one final remark. If you want to reach the synthetic generation, you should consider working with influencers. Thank you very much.
Thank you, John. So we're running a little bit late in the program, not because of you, but because of me. But I still have a question for you, because this is an audience of technology decision makers, mm-hmm. not specifically marketeers, though there might be one or two. But I'm really fascinated. So let's say that this world moves to these computer-generated influencers, mm-hmm. and because a normal influencer, you always run the risk that when your big, wonderful influencer gets arrested
like Tiger Woods.
For whatever, or the Tiger Woods effect, then mm-hmm. it will have an adverse effect on your mm-hmm. brand. So let's say the marketing department of these companies decides we want to have a virtual influencer. And then they come to the CIO mm-hmm. and say, can you please build us a virtual influencer? Then what is your advice to the CIOs? Where do they go? Where do they start with these little Michaelas?
Yeah, well, two things are very important. First of all, you got to have the right data of your audience. Your audience, maybe you have personas, maybe you scan the World Wide Web, maybe you scan the social media profiles of the people liking your Facebook pages, your LinkedIn pages, so that data will come up with a certain profile, topics, interests that you want to address, that you want to make content about. And secondly, that's another thing. You would want to make a profile for the virtual influencer that really fits your brand profile. So it should be the living and breathing embodiment of the brand.
So, and when you are in contact with your clients, do they have this data that you are asking for? Do they have it? Or they have it, but can they present it to you in a coordinated way? Or is that where the trouble lies?
That's a good question, because it's most of the time it's locked up in behind Facebook or Instagram. So you really gotta invest in good software to get the data, to get the right profiles, and see what your target audience, your fans, your consumers are really about. So okay. That's something you should look into.
Okay. So there's one critical question that we can address about: aren't you a little bit worried about the Gandhi or Luther Kings of this new generation is Kylie Jenner? Is that the role model for this new generation, or are they looking beyond this?
It's a good question. You see a transition from big influencers, and already the newer generation looks towards those big influencers and sees them as inauthentic. So that's also the shift to the smaller influencers, people like you and me, that's going on here. So they know it's fake, but they still like to see it. It's also a bit entertainment, a bit of a reality show factor in this. So, but yes, people that have a real expertise, a real passion, and that's not Kylie Jenner, they have a profound impact on their audience.
Okay.
But it's also because they're genuine.
Okay. Thank you very much, John.
Thank you.
So.